Very important tool. Whether the scientists are interested in agriculture biology or biology targeted to understanding how our cells and organisms are working to be able to develop new therapeutics, the technology is very useful because we depend on genetic tools. We want to understand the genetic basis of diseases, so we need really tools that allow to do proper genetic, and this tool really allows to simplify the life of the biologists who want to understand the mechanisms of life. And it has a lot of application in medicine, indirectly or directly, because it really allows to develop some screening methods, to develop new therapeutics, and also allows to develop models of disease that are very useful to test new drugs in development. And ultimately, we hope, and myself, I have particular hope that it will be really useful as a direct tool to treat serious human genetic disorders, for which there is still a lack of technology to have a proper therapy. As a direct approach, the technology could really be used to correct cells of a patient, with the idea to collect the cells that have a genetic modification, correct the genetic modification and reimplant back the healthy cells in a patient. And the first diseases that could be targeted are diseases that affect the blood or the liver, just because those cells are easily reachable. So we all think that, at least as a proof of concept, to really show that the technology could be useful to treat human genetic disorders, those diseases affecting the blood and the liver could be the one of the first diseases that could be tested. Personally, I don't think that it is acceptable to manipulate the human germline for the purpose of changing some genetic traits that will be transmitted over generations.
Even if it would cure horrendous diseases?
I think right now it's way too early to say it, and personally it's just a personal statement. At this point, I will not, you know, it's a personal statement. For me, I have just a problem right now with regard to the manipulation.
It is essential that the genetic modification of human embryos is allowed, says a group of scientists, ethicists and policy experts. A Hingston Group report says editing the genetic code of early-stage embryos is of tremendous value to research. It adds, although GM babies should not be allowed to be born at the moment, it may be morally acceptable under some circumstances in the future. The US refuses to fund research involving the gene editing of embryos. The Global Hingston Group met in response to the phenomenal advances taking place in the field of genetics. A range of novel techniques combine a molecular sat-nav that travels to a precise location in our DNA with a pair of molecular scissors that cut it. It has transformed research in a wide range of fields, but the progress means genetically modified babies are ceasing to be a prospect and fast becoming a possibility. Earlier this year, a team at Sun Yat-sen University, in China, showed that errors in the DNA that led to a blood disorder could be corrected in early-stage embryos. In the future, the technologies could be used to prevent children being born with cystic fibrosis or genes that increase the risk of cancer. Embryo engineering dominates debate around these novel gene editing tools. But while disease-free children or designer babies may be on the horizon, the more immediate uses are far less controversial. It could restore the reputation of the field of gene therapy in adults and children. It was nearly a success in children with no immune system, known as bubble boy syndrome. Symptoms improved, but the technique led to cancer in some cases. These more accurate tools may be able to tweak our genetic code without the side effects. There have even been successful trials to give HIV patients immunity to the virus. And because these changes would not be passed on to the next generation, they are far less controversial. There have been calls for a moratorium on such research, which has left many asking where to draw the line. Should any embryo research be banned, should it be allowed but only for research, or should GM babies be permitted? A meeting of the influential Hingston Group, in Manchester, acknowledged that the rate of progress meant there was a pressure to make decisions and argued embryo editing should be allowed. In a statement, it said, We believe that while this technology has tremendous value to basic research and enormous potential, it is not sufficiently developed to consider human genome editing for clinical reproductive purposes at this time. This is in stark contrast to the U.S. National Institutes of Health, which has already refused to fund any gene editing of embryos. Its director, Dr. Francis Collins, who was also a key player in the Human Genome Project, said, "The concept of altering the human germline, inherited DNA, in embryos for clinical purposes has been debated over many years from many different perspectives, and has been viewed almost universally as a line that should not be crossed." However, the Hinkston Group's full report acknowledges that there may be morally acceptable uses of this technology in human reproduction, though further substantial discussion and debate will be required. But even one of the principal figures in the discovery and development of CRISPR, one of the easiest methods of editing DNA, has doubts. Professor Emmanuel Charpentier told BBC News, "Personally, I don't think it is acceptable to manipulate the human germline for the purpose of changing some genetic traits that will be transmitted over generations. I just have a problem right now with regard to the manipulation of the human germlines." Dr. Peter Mills, from the Nuffield Council on Bioethics, added, "We have seen these uses coming over the horizon, but we need to decide whether we're going to invite them in when they reach our doorstep." What is the Hinkston Group? The Hinkston Group describes itself as an international consortium on stem cells, ethics and law, and brings together researchers, bioethicists and policy experts from around the world. Named after the Cambridgeshire village in the UK where the group first met, its members aim to explore the ethical and policy challenges of transnational scientific collaboration raised by variations in national regulations.